All right, so picture this. You're on the verge of launching your dream dental practice, but suddenly everything goes off script. Costs skyrocket, timelines stretch, and your support system seems to take an unexpected vacation. So how do you navigate chaos and still come out on top? Join us as we explore the art of managing expectations and turning unexpected obstacles into opportunity. Welcome to episode 37, Behind the Smiles. Managing the unexpected in dentistry and in life. We're your hosts. I'm Dr. John.
I'm Allison. Let's get started.
Thanks for joining us.
At the Health Revolution podcast, we firmly believe that mental and physical health are linked, and it's impossible to achieve optimal health without addressing both.
You'll learn how to optimize your nutrition, manage stress, and cultivate a positive mindset.
We'll share personal stories and practical advice along the way to help you live a healthier and happier life, one that's full of energy, vitality, and joy.
So whether you're struggling with chronic health issues, feeling stressed, or simply looking to optimize your overall well-being, we're here to help.
Let's embark on this journey towards optimal health and wellness together.
All right, John, that introduction seemed to hit a little close to home. And if our listeners have been listening to our previous episodes, I think they know that you've been trying to open up a new dental practice.
We have, yes.
And this was supposed to open up in November.
2 months ago, yeah.
3 months ago, yeah. And is it open yet? Not quite.
Tomorrow, we actually see our first patients.
Yeah. So that introduction, we were talking, you were mentioning like all the things that were kind of going wrong, all the expectations you had that were kind of falling by the wayside. You ended up spending a lot more on this practice.
Probably in the realm of $150,000 to $250,000 more than I expected it to cost me.
Okay, so that's...
That's like a Lamborghini Huracan.
Well, that's like more than most people make in maybe... 2 years
yes.
in practice.
Yes.
And so that's a lot of money.
It
and
is.
Maybe that's the cost of most people, just the practice in and of itself.
It can be very expensive to open a practice. And, you know, as you know, being by my side, we've done this. This is our fifth time.
Yeah.
Opening up another office.
It's been, and every time you've opened an office, there's been a challenge of some sort that arises. It never goes smoothly, but you don't know what those challenges are going to be until they come up.
No, but they can be very debilitating. I mean, you know, if we're completely honest, I haven't exactly handled the inception of these other four offices with, you know,
as much grace and as much resilience as you had
correct.
In this one. Yeah.
Correct.
I would say that's very accurate. This is the first time you've had a partner to help open the practice. And that hasn't exactly gone as expected either because of the delay of the time. And then it backed right up to his vacation that he'd been planning with his family for a while. And it was just one thing after another with expectations that kind of we have when we're doing a project like this, and that it doesn't always go to plan.
And I think you hit the nail on the head right there, and it's expectations.
Yeah. Tell me about that.
So, you know, we mentioned on our last podcast, one of my favorite phrases about expectations.
Lead to?
Premeditated resentment. So whenever you have an expectation that something is going to go a certain way, I mean, I love the quote of man plans and God laughs.
Mm-hmm.
Because we can plan for the unexpected, but it seems like we get frustrated when it happens.
Yeah. So I've been frustrated for you. I think like you'll come home and you'll just be like, oh my gosh, this thing happened. And, you know, I'm okay, but it's just frustrating. And I'm like, frustrating. This is not right. Then,
oh,
you know,
goodness.
I sound like a little chihuahua sometimes.
You
probably.
Do.
I'm like, I'm going to go to battle for you and tell me what I can do and hold me back. You know,
yeah,
I'm going to.
You're like that Coke can that has been shaken up and then you go to open it and it explodes.
Yeah. Well, so there's been several things that have been happening, but one of the things has been like the telephone company. First, they gave you in advance, they're like, here's the phone number that you'll have when you open. And so you printed that on all your letterhead, all your business cards, like $1,000 worth of merchandise and everything.
And then they came back and they're like, whoops, that's not your phone number.
Yeah. And then just recently they said, oh, the phones aren't working, or.
Oh my goodness. They installed the wrong hardware in our building.
Oh,
and they took fault. They accepted fault for that, but
that doesn't make your phones work.
It doesn't make my phones work. And so, you know, now here I am going to the Apple store, getting an iPhone so we can forward all of our digital lines over to our iPhone, so our office manager can start taking calls.
Oh my goodness.
And so there's been a lot of that shifting gears and moving forward. And I could do one of two things. I could sit back and be pissed off and fret about it, or we can figure out alternatives.
Yeah, and it's like every problem that comes along, you just find a solution.
Yeah,
like problem.
But if I sit there and I stew over these problems, then nothing gets done.
Do you think your background in computers, like when you were doing tech support, has kind of prepared you for this sort of thing? Because there was always a problem. There was like always an error on the computer. There was always some either faulty hardware or software, and you're just always fixing.
It's living a life of troubleshooting, I think. That, yeah, when things go wrong, it's important to find out why they went wrong and then pick yourself up by the bootstraps and move forward.
Yeah, I think, like, I just look at your life and you've done this your whole life, whether you've been fixing cars or the dirt bikes or even the house, like the plumbing and all of this stuff. It's just like, okay, why is this happening? Let's fix it.
That actually has become easier as I've practiced it.
Mm-hmm.
But early on in my career, I would like to say that I led a life of toxic positivity, that you know, I would bury the negative and highlight the positive, but all the while those negative feelings and emotions would then
fester
inside, and then I would blow my top.
Yeah.
Versus now, when the negative happens, it's okay to acknowledge that the negative happened and then move forward.
That's really wise. So that's kind of what we want to talk about today, is this myth that we kind of live of control.
Yeah.
I mean, we're going to be talking about your practice specifically, but if you don't have a dental practice, or
this could be in your family,
it's with
dynamic.
Anything. It's with
your work dynamic. Mm-hmm. It could be
with your own personal health. It could be so many things that this relates to, but specifically we're talking, and then the episode is called Behind the Smiles, because it's a play on words. I hope you caught that, but
that was so cute.
I know, dental practice, but also, like you just said, a lot of times you like bury all those feelings and emotions, and they either like cause a lot of physical manifestations in our body. Like we'll start getting GI problems, or even an autoimmune, or even cancer. Like all of these will fester in us if we don't work out a positive way to address them and release them.
Absolutely. And do you want a real good way to make others' lives miserable? That's for you to allow these things to fester and not show up the way that you're supposed to.
Yeah. I mean, you can't be yourself if your body's not functioning.
No, it really, it affects your authenticity.
Yeah. And if you're burying all that and you're super stressed on the inside and just faking the smile, like you said, you're not authentic, not to yourself and not to other people. And then there's this harmony that's not happening within yourself and within your relationships.
Correct. I don't believe in fake it till you make it. I think that that's a major blow to one's authenticity. And unless we are living an authentic life, we can never be happy.
Yeah. I just thought of an idiom. Is that what you call it?
Okay.
Fake it till you make it. Is that an idiom?
I think so. Yeah. I don't know. I'm not the English person.
Okay. So you do speak English though.
It, but I don't know it.
I just thought, smile through your trial. That's so good. It just popped in my brain. I'm sure I'm not the first person that thought of that, but I believe in that to an extent. Like you can always find something positive in any circumstance. But like sometimes you just need to have that emotion of anger or fear or sadness or whatever it is. And we talk about that a lot, of how to manage those emotions that come up.
Absolutely.
So the first thing I want to address is the myth of control. Okay. So we have this illusion in life a lot of times that we have control. And this is very important for our human brains to feel like we're in control, because that feels very safe and comfortable.
Uh-huh.
And so when we're talking about dental practice, you know, you have your weekly hours, your daily times that you come in, you have your schedule, you have the employees, mm-hmm. and you know, everybody has their certain job and this sort of thing. And it begins to feel at some point like you have control.
Correct.
And not in a bad way, like you're this controlling dictator, but just like, okay, I'm the boss. Things are rolling.
I've got the horse by the reins.
Yeah. And it does feel good. I imagine when you are feeling that sense of control.
Sure.
But I think
what happens when crap hits the fan?
So yeah. So the thing I was thinking of is during COVID.
Let's not even go back that far. Let's go back 2 months ago.
Okay.
When we had not 2 months ago, but a month ago when we had a Christmas party.
Yeah. And oh my gosh. Yes.
Okay. Four key employees.
They all shared a ride to the Christmas party and shared other things.
They shared a ride to the Christmas party. And when they got to the Christmas party, we all had a blast.
Yeah.
And then they went home from the Christmas party. And what happened? One of them had a little sore throat.
Yeah, they shared more than a ride. They shared germs.
They did. And every single one of them wound up with not only the flu, but COVID.
Mm-hmm.
And then coming back into a very busy week of surgery.
Oh my gosh, it's like the busiest time of year
for you. And not enough employees to actually do the job.
Yeah.
So let's go back that far.
Yeah, let's do that.
That hasn't been that long, and that could potentially be a really, really frustrating thing.
Yeah, so you walk into work, and like none of your assistants are there.
Yeah, three of the four assistants that got sick are out.
You literally need assistants to do the work that you're doing. You can't do it without them.
Correct. Yeah. I mean, it got to the point to where we were missing so many assistants that I took a couple of days off just to thin the schedule out and allowed my partners to do the production in the office mm-hmm. those couple of days.
And there's no way you could have scheduled that or predicted
No, you can never schedule sickness. It just happens.
Yeah. And so what do you do under that circumstance, those unforeseen circumstances of half of your assistants getting sick?
I sit back and I ask myself questions.
Okay.
Like, you know, let's talk about what we know first off. We know that the offices are very successful.
Okay.
We know that this is going to be temporary.
That must feel good.
That does feel good. And then the question that I have to ask myself is, what impact will this have on the office in 1 year? Or what impact will this have on the office in 5 years?
I love that because we feel like it's so important right now. Like this is so painful.
Yes.
And so pressing.
Yes.
And it's such a big problem that when you kind of have that lens of like the future.
You take the urgency out of it. And then all of a sudden your problems really are not all that bad.
Mm.
I mean, look at it. I still have my hands. I can operate. My assistants, I know, will heal.
Mm-hmm.
And we can just take a couple of days off, which I really enjoyed, by the way, because it allowed me to get some things straightened out in my personal life.
Yeah.
And then we can just hit the ground running again, which we did.
You did.
The other option is I could force the schedule in my office.
And what would that do?
I could come in and say, you know what, guys? Yeah, we only have 50% of the employees in the office right now. Let's do it anyway.
Let's go 100%, even though we only have 50%
to give. And I could then burn out all my employees.
And they would hate you or resent you at least.
I could burn out myself and I would hate me. And I could come home in a really bad mood and you would hate me.
I feel like we've done that before and it didn't work out very well.
It hasn't in the past. And so I felt like it was time for a change maybe.
Yeah. That's so good. But like those experiences come from a lot of error in the past.
It does.
Like, let's not repeat that.
Like,
again.
Remember what happened the last time that you got stressed out like this? And it led to, for instance, a relapse
mm-hmm.
or multiple relapses or my health would
decline. Sure. Like mental and physical. And then, you know, it's like snapping at the kids or snapping at someone at the grocery store, like just doing things that you wouldn't normally do just because you're feeling and harboring that extra stress that you're putting on yourself and everybody else. And you're forgetting that like, this isn't going to really matter that much in the long
run. I think it's important to take into consideration the human component of things
mm-hmm.
that we're not all good and all bad or all right and all wrong. There's so many gray areas in between and enjoy a little bit of flexibility.
I love that.
Because of the human component.
Yeah, that's so true. My assistant just posted something on Facebook and I really loved it. It was talking about when someone has a bad moment, you know, like let's say you would snap at somebody in the family, and we'd say, "Oh, you're showing your true colors." And it was saying like, why do we say that is their true colors when most of the time they've been a good, decent human being, but they just had this one moment where it was like, I can't handle it. And it's gotten to be too much. It's like, why can't all of that be our true colors? And we can just acknowledge that we have like this
for good or for bad. Yeah, we have each other.
Yeah. And we have, all of us have that within us. And it's like, what do we want to lean into more? Well, we want to lean into that goodness a little more. I think most of us, we're not trying to be evil or angry or,
you know, I've always held the belief that that people are inherently good. Mm-hmm. And if we can look for that, those are our true colors.
Yeah, I think so. Sorry. I think we got a little off topic.
I see your true colors. Oh, the song.
It's like Elton. No, it's not Elton John.
I don't know who the heck that is.
Yeah. But tell us if you guys remember who that is, let us know. At Peterson Family Coaching, we've developed a 16-week Fat to Fuel program that aims to improve both mental and physical health. This program is for you if you are over 40 and have a hard time losing weight, suffer from chronic inflammation, or simply want to add more happiness and better health to your life. On top of video trainings, you will work one-on-one with a coach to learn self-compassion, self-discipline, and how to manage your feelings. You will lose excess body weight, reduce symptoms of sickness, and potentially reduce or eliminate the need for prescription drugs. This program will transform your life so you never have to be where you are right now ever again. Click the link in the show notes or head over to fattofuel.com to get started today. Use the coupon code REVOLUTION to claim 10% off. Okay, so I'm thinking of this when you have setbacks, the word resilience.
Yes.
That is like a key word here because that resilience is like that bounce back, right? Mm-hmm. Maintaining that positive mindset during those challenging times. So mm-hmm. Where have you seen this resilience? Like when you have the resilience, you emerge and you're stronger for it. Like let's say with your dental practice.
Well, how about the office that I'm opening right now?
Okay.
I mean, it's really interesting to be around so many wonderful and beautiful personalities and watch what happens to them when they encounter a stressful moment. Case in point, you know, last week was like crunch time. We didn't even have furniture to open the office up.
That was another one of the expectations.
Yeah. Lighting. We didn't have our lighting.
Yeah.
It was ridiculous. But
well, and the designer ordered this chandelier that was like,
oh my goodness,
4 feet by 4 feet. It was.
Oh, I would have hit my head in the hallway going, I would have had to duck just to go underneath the dang thing. So, you know, and she expected that to fit better than it did.
Uh-huh.
But back to resilience, there were some beautiful, beautiful personalities in our office that would get really stressed out to the point of not being able to see through it to the finish line.
Yeah.
And I kept
boss.
Having to say many times, do you guys remember 4 years ago when we opened up the Mesa office?
Yeah.
We opened that up and we didn't even have a wall or doors for our consultation room. Yet we got through that.
Did they remember?
Once I mentioned that to them.
They were like, oh yeah.
It's like we are so much further along in organization opening up this Queen Creek office than what we ever were for the Mesa office. And we wanted to put out that A+.
Mm.
You know, being 100% prepared, all the I's dotted and all of the T's crossed. And we just can't do that. Sometimes B- is the best we can do, or even A- for that goes. I think right now Queen Creek's at an A-.
Oh,
but,
yeah?
But Mesa was at a B- when we opened those doors, yet we all still made it. And what made it was the fact that nobody gave up. And we just kept pushing forward.
Okay, so this is reminding me of a quote by Charles Darwin. He's known for
saying, the father of evolution.
Yeah. And he's known for saying like the strongest will survive.
Yes.
Or that's what people quote him as saying a lot of times. But listen to this. It is not the strongest of the species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but the one most responsive to change.
There you go.
Do you love that?
I absolutely love that.
I totally agree with that. It doesn't uh-huh. matter how strong you are or how smart you are. But if you adapt to change, you will come out ahead.
Yeah. And whenever I hire a new employee, that's one of the things that I tell them every single time is our business is fluid. Our business is evolutionary. And unless you are willing to change with the times, your business will fail.
You know, back when I worked at a law office, I was trying to find somebody to replace me. And so I was interviewing these women that were coming in, and when I had them sit down at the computer and I said, okay, do this on the computer, you know, just seeing if they knew how to do certain skills.
Yeah.
And this one woman was like, she just put her hands up. She's like, I don't know how to do that. Or I've never done that before. And she's like, oh, I don't know that. Mm-hmm. And she was just like stagnant. Like she wouldn't even try. And then another woman, she also didn't know the skill, but she's like, hold on, I think I can figure this out. Just give me a minute. And she's poking around and trying to figure, she goes, maybe I go over here and do this way. And like, she was totally getting it wrong.
Yeah.
But I was like, this is the person you need to hire.
Yes.
Because she had that resilient attitude where she was like, even if I don't know, like she doesn't have the intelligence, she's not the strongest, but she had that, she's responsive.
Yes.
You know, she was like, I will figure this out.
Yep.
And I'm like, that is a characteristic that you cannot give somebody all the time. I mean, people can learn it throughout their life, but it's like.
And those are the employees that survive in my business is the ones that, and I tell them up front, listen, I'm not going to tell you how to do your job. And I'm also, you need to be open to the fact that the job you're being hired for right now is going to change. It's not a matter of if it changes, it will. Mm-hmm. And you need to roll with that.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to tell you how you do your job. You have a brain. I want you to use that and figure out these problems for you.
I love that. And as a boss, that's really, I mean,
it's empowering.
Yeah. It's empowering for your employee. Is it empowering for you as well?
Absolutely.
Like, how do you let go of that control or that sense of control to allow to just.
Now that is a major skill that requires learning, and that is trust.
Mm.
And trust is not, it's not what people think it is. In my opinion, I think, you know, when you trust somebody, it's that, you know, I trust that you're going to do this the way that I want it done.
Mm.
That's not trust.
Okay.
Trust is whatever you do, I'm okay with it.
Wow.
Now that is such a hard skill to master.
That really is. It's
whatever you do, I'm okay with it. And that's the person, that's the relationship that I have with my employees.
That's awesome. And what if you have an employee that you just can't trust? Is that when you let them go or you work with them?
My preference is for employees to see themselves out, and I will keep working with them and keep struggling with them until either they quit and they realize, okay, this job is not for me, or there's just no other way past it.
That's and so rare too.
It is. I've happened. Only in the last 10 years, I've had to dismiss 3 employees and the rest of all either stayed with me or they've upgraded their careers. And that's what I want.
That's always fun.
My employees, man, I tell you, and I've told them this before, if you are still with me in 10 years, I may be disappointed.
Yeah, because you want them to grow and maybe even outgrow.
Outgrow me. Please outgrow me. I welcome that. I'll find somebody else to fill your shoes, but please outgrow me.
Or if they're like so amazing that you can't live without them, it's like, let's give you more responsibility.
More responsibility, more pay with respect to your responsibility, and let's see what you can do.
It's been amazing.
I think
you're an amazing boss. I do.
I am an amazing boss.
I'm glad you think so.
And my employees think I'm an amazing boss.
I love that. Well, okay. So what about being flexible and adaptable? You're just talking about that with your employees. And what about that with you and opening up this new office? How did you have that flexibility and that adaptability when things weren't going your way? Your expectations weren't met.
I think that we need to look at the past and realize that things did work out. And sometimes things work out in a different timeline than what you might expect them to. And hold on to that. Hold on to the faith that things will work out.
I think of the phone thing. You were like, okay, let's buy an iPhone. You know, like not everybody would think of that. They would just be like, the phones aren't working. The phones aren't working. Like we can't do anything until the phones are working. And it's like, you're like, okay, the phones aren't working. What can we do? I know a place that sells phones. We have an iPhone. We bought an iPhone.
Yep.
Reroute the phone. Like that's like the flexible aspect mm-hmm. of like, let's just find the solution, or maybe it's not the way we wanted it to be.
No, but it's enough.
Mm-hmm.
It's enough. Whatever we're doing, it's enough. It's adequate. And people can be communicated with, even though it's not perfect. And letting go of perfect, I think, is another thing that adds to flexibility and adaptability.
Do you think a lot of dentists struggle with perfectionism?
I know. I mean, that's actually one of the things they point at, that dentists have a higher suicide rate than most other careers,
yeah,
is because we are perfectionists.
So I was just reading, I read a lot about dental practitioners and their mental health.
Yes.
I don't think we've mentioned it on this program before, but maybe we have. But John and I are working together to create a course. It'd be a membership and
yes. Specifically for dentists and their spouses.
Yeah. And so to really address like the issues that dental practitioners and their spouses face, we've been studying a lot about their mental and physical health. Mm-hmm. And one of the research that I just read this week was that, yes, the suicide rate is up with dentists 7.3% more than the American average.
Yeah. And then talk about substance abuse as well is up.
Yeah. And the depression and the anxiety is increased. But not only that, they don't think that they should ask for help.
No. They think I am smart enough. I should be able to figure this out. I went to dental school. If I have a health problem, I'm smart enough. I should be able to figure this out. I don't need to go to a physician to tell them what's wrong with me.
Right. And so with the perfectionism, it's like acknowledging that there is something wrong with you, acknowledging that you need help. Mm-hmm. That's a big deal. And then acknowledging that maybe there's nothing that can be done, or maybe there is, like, you have to look into that. And just mm-hmm. looking into that is very hard for
Correct.
A lot of dentists.
Correct.
And so I was like, why do they have depression and anxiety? And we'll talk about this in a future episode, but really what it came down to is many of them are solopreneurs.
Yes.
Working on
solopreneurs, meaning a solo practitioner.
Yeah.
Yes.
And they're working.
So they become an island.
Yes.
Amongst themselves in a sea of women.
Yeah. And that's why the course that we are launching is going to have support group meetings, and it's going to be awesome. So we'll have group meetings for John to meet with the dentist, for me to meet with the spouses, and for us all to meet together. And it'll be mm-hmm. three meetings a month, and it's going to be awesome. But the other reason they tend to be more perfectionists is because they're doctors, but have a very tiny, tiny space.
A very specialized niche.
Very niche. And then there's specialists within that niche, like you or endodontists, who are just doing the tiniest thing and just a fraction of a millimeter.
Oh, a millimeter might as well be a mile for us.
Yeah, it makes a huge difference. So you have this like very high stress and job.
And then the expectation of the patient coming in, well, I hate dentists.
Yeah.
No offense, but I hate dentists.
That's my mom and your mom. It's like every time.
Oh, okay. Well, you don't really know me, but all right.
I'm sorry.
Sorry.
You start your day off apologizing for living a lot of times. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's so hard. So anyway, we digress with the perfectionism that you have to let a lot of that go, that innate personality trait that mm-hmm. you have that makes you such an amazing dentist. You have to let a lot of that go when it comes to running the practice mm-hmm. and being with your patients and managing your staff.
I like the Marine Corps, one of their mottos, right? Improvise, adapt, overcome.
That's awesome.
Yeah. I love that. It's beautiful. It's simplistic. And it's the way that I strive to live my life.
I think you've quoted this before, Alan Saunders. Life is what happens when you're busy making other plans.
Isn't that great?
Just enjoy like what you have.
Oh my gosh.
You know,
yeah.
You're busy making plans, but life's happening right now. And I always remember like in school, we're like, oh my gosh, it'll just be so great when we're done with school. And then we're done with school. Oh, it'll be so great once we can buy our house, once we pay off student loans, once we open up our own practice.
But what about the right here and
like
the right now?
Life is happening right now. Like our baby is taking their first steps.
Yes.
You know, our son just created his first robot or whatever.
The pumpkin festival with the kids.
Yeah.
All the simple things.
Enjoying those moments. So we've talked about learning from our challenges, learning from those setbacks. What about finding those silver linings? This is the conclusion of the podcast today. Let's look at the takeaways from all the growth, all the learning, all the adaptability, all the letting go of perfectionism, finding those silver linings. How do you embrace that unpredictability of life?
You know, I think it's important in order to live a balanced life. In fact, I just had a on my way home, I had a little coaching session with somebody who he said, listen, you know, the last 2 weeks, he's had quote unquote, the efforts.
I get those.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think that it's important. And I mentioned before earlier in the podcast that I used to be one that was that indulged in toxic positivity. Mm-hmm. I could find a silver lining in everything.
Yeah.
Shoot. I was sitting in rehab and I could find a silver lining. But it's important to acknowledge the negative in mm-hmm. life. If we don't acknowledge the negative in life, then we can never truly find the positive or the silver lining.
That 50-50 balance is always so important. The world shows us that life is meant to be 50-50.
Yes.
Darkness and light, land and water,
yes.
Sky, and I mean, all of that.
And so with this client, that's what I encouraged him to do. I said, do not miss this opportunity to feel those efforts as deep as they go.
Yeah.
Feel it, experience it, get curious about it, and then move on.
I had this experience in the car I was telling you about not too long ago on my way home from the hospital visiting a friend. And I was just like mad. I was so mad
for her.
And I'm like, I'm going to feel all these feelings right now. It's probably not the safest place because I was driving, but I had like angry hot tears coming out of my eyeballs. And I was just like, oh my gosh, I'm just like releasing all those emotions and just,
I remember that,
so upset. And then I start getting upset about like other things too, that I didn't realize I'd been harboring. I'd been pushing those down mm-hmm. and not allowing myself to feel all the anger.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my gosh, I am so angry. And I was like, angry, angry, angry. By the time I got home, it was about a 20-minute drive. I felt so much better.
Absolutely. And no amount of happiness you can experience will ever compensate for not feeling the negativity.
Absolutely. So I think about that movie, the Pixar movie.
Which one?
The emotions.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
What is it called?
It's called, I don't know. This is good. I blocked that out of my memory.
No, the Pixar movie where they have the emotions.
About the feelings. They have the little emotion balls and everything like that.
Okay, so the ones with the feelings. And we have Joy is her name, and sadness. And they're on this like adventure together. And Joy keeps saying like, oh, come on, we're just going to have a party. And we're going to be so happy and everything's going to be great. And then they're trying to wake up Riley, the main character, because these are like her emotions that are in, if you haven't seen it, I mean, you have to
see it. Oh, it's so good.
But they're trying to wake her up from her dream. And Joy is like, we're just going to be so happy that she's going to wake up in this positive mood. And sadness just keeps trying to be like, oh, we're so sad. And Joy just keeps trying to push her away and push her away. And Riley's like breaking down.
Yeah.
And no amount of joy is allowing her to feel her feelings. And finally, sadness takes over and Riley has like this moment where she's just like sad and feeling all of that emotion and pain. And then she's able to rebuild after that and like totally restructures her whole brain.
So take those opportunities to feel the negative. That's okay. It's okay when things don't work out, and it's okay to feel that things didn't work out because it's clearing for us emotionally.
Yeah. And I'm telling you, there is always a silver lining in anything that we go through.
Absolutely.
And so it's so important, like you said, to feel those feelings, but then spend some time meditating on all the good, all the positive, because there is so much. I promise you, in any trial and challenge in your life, there is something there that you've learned, that you've experienced, that no one can take away from you.
And I think that the key there is maybe not necessarily trying to find those positive things, but being grateful. Gratitude is an incredible medicine that counteracts negativity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, releases all those good hormones into your body and everything mm-hmm. like that. So
I'm like, listen, I'm fat, but I have such pretty eyes.
You are not, but yes, you do. You're a dork. Don't say that about yourself. Oh no, you are so handsome and I love you so much. And I'm so glad we could record this episode together. I hope it's helped you. If it has, please go to the episode, scroll down, give us that 5-star rating, leave us a review. It is so helpful for more people to see this podcast mm-hmm. and so that we can hear back from you and so we know what you want to hear more of.
And let's end with an inspiring quote.
Okay, ready? Franklin D. Roosevelt. Go ahead.
The only limit to our realization of tomorrow will be our doubts of today.
Ooh.
Ooh. And I think about that.
Deep. Okay. Next week, we're going to be talking about expectations we have for our people in our life.
So we're trying to do 3 parts, right? Yeah. We talked, introduced expectations today and how toxic that can be. Next week is expectations of others. Mm-hmm. And last of all,
it's a big deal, by the way.
It is. It's huge.
It's life-changing.
It's life-changing. And then the last one that's hardest for all of us to swallow, expectations of ourselves.
Yep. All right. We're lining it up for you. You guys tune in. We'll see you then.
Take care.
Bye-bye. I hope you found value in what you heard today. If so, please follow us and go give us that 5-star rating. It really helps us reach more people that need to hear this message. Also, if you're ready to make changes to your health and well-being, go check out our Fat to Fuel program. Our coaching program empowers you to make healthy changes to your life one step at a time. Go to fattofuel.com or click the link in the show notes. We hope to see you there.